The torts question from July of 1993 gives us a nice chance to review a fair amount of the torts outline substantively. In my judgment, this is not one of the most difficult torts questions, but there's plenty that we can learn from it. Please turn with me to the call of the question. Paul has sued Dina and Mary, alleging tortious causes of action. There's no mystery here. 1. Is Paul entitled to recover against Dina for assault, discuss, battery, discuss? Well, this is not very hard to outline. We know the elements, and we've got a plaintiff versus a defendant in torts. 2. The more complicated question. Is Paul entitled to recover against Mary? A. On the ground that Mary was negligent as to Paul. B. On the ground that Mary is vicariously liable. Well, we know how to organize the negligence issue. The vicarious liability issue is going to be more dependent on the facts. So, let's review the fact pattern briefly. Let's go to the top and have a look at it. In paragraph 1, we meet defendant Dina, who is 16, living at home with her mother, Mary. So right away we're filled in a little bit about the vicarious liability issue. We've got a question involving a parent's vicarious liability for the tortious acts of her child. And we know that parents typically are not vicariously liable for the conduct of their kids. We read on in paragraph 1, Mary knows that Dina has exhibited violent and delusionary conduct based on schizophrenia and has attacked people in the neighborhood. Medication will work, and Dina has stopped taking it without her mother's knowledge. And that fact probably will give rise to claims against Mary for her own negligence in failing to keep this daughter on her meds. In paragraph 2, we find out about a confrontation between Dina and Paul. In this confrontation, Dina, without provocation, gestures threateningly and screams, "I know you're out to get me, and I'm going to get you first." We'll have to talk about this first confrontation, but to my way of thinking, there's no tortious behavior here at all. Maybe bizarre behavior, but nothing actionable. In paragraph 3, Paul calls Mary, the mom, and Mary tells Paul, quote, "Dina has sometimes made threats to others, but I do not think she will try to hurt you, and I assure you that this will not happen again." Well, by making that assurance, Mary has assumed a duty, even if she didn't have one before that. Paul believes Mary's assurances and doesn't try to stay away from Dina as a result. In the next paragraph, we see Mary confronting her daughter about the incident and Dina saying she's taking her meds, and the mom does nothing. Perhaps that's a breach of duty. 2 days later, a second confrontation between Dina and Paul occurs, and she rides her bicycle quickly at Paul, and Paul jumps out of the way, even though she wouldn't have actually hit him, and by diving away, he suffers a severe concussion and facial injuries when his face has a harmful and unpermitted contact with the pavement. And you've probably done quite a few torts multi-state questions about the transferred intent issue. And certainly we're going to call this a battery, even though Dina did not physically strike our plaintiff. Then we get the call of the question again, and it seems quite straightforward now, perhaps even more so than it did when we first looked at the call of the question. So next, please turn with me and have a look at the outline of issues that I've written for this essay question. And here you're going to see that this is a particularly skeletal outline. This outline is less dense than many of the others that we will see both in this seminar and throughout the Master Essay Method course. But take a look. Importantly, with regard to the assault issue, notice how I am not organizing the analysis around the elements of assault. Instead, I am organizing the assault analysis around the two different incidents. And the reason is that allows us to do a more thorough analysis, and it also allows us to distinguish the first incident from the second one. Next, we focus on battery, and all I use here are elements, intent, and causation reaching a conclusion. One certainly could do a more intricate job of organizing this part of the analysis. But if you did, don't think I would fault you for it. My concern is to make sure that our answers are reasonably well organized and that they are complete. So almost any time you go into a little bit more detail, breaking things down into somewhat smaller pieces than I do, almost always I will be your cheerleader in that regard. Next, we move to what I consider to be the more complicated issues, those involving Paul's action against Mary, the mom. With regard to negligence, you'll see I don't do anything innovative here. I just break negligence down into the elements, and I'm prepared to dissect the elements. And with regard to vicarious liability, at the outlining stage, I don't even have anything to say internally in terms of organization. We're going to focus on vicarious liability and do all of it in an analysis without further internal headings. Now, let's have a look together at the answer that I've written. And here again, I don't think there's going to be anything terribly innovative or clever, but I do think you will see, once again, a number of examples of reasonably precise and fact-centered analysis. Notice up front with regard to Paul versus Dina, I lead with a definition for a change, a very short definition of assault. Then I indicate that we're going to need to analyze two different sets of facts, the face-to-face threat and the bicycle ride. And as you look at those two paragraphs, what I think you will see is I do a very comprehensive job of finding a home for the facts. Our central task in bar exam essay analysis work, connecting the facts to the legal principles that resolve the issues between the litigants. Ultimately, I conclude that Dina is going to be liable in tort for Paul's injuries, and I indicate that will include the medical treatment and pain and suffering, and that punitive damages may also be awarded given the intentional nature of Dina's misconduct. Next, we turn to battery. We spent all this time just considering assault. Now here, I don't talk about the two incidents separately. I focus on the second incident in which the plaintiff actually suffered his injuries. I focus on intent and causation. And here you're going to notice that, again, I am very meticulously going over the specific facts and reaching very specific conclusions. Here again, the plaintiff wins. He gets compensatory and punitive damages against this kid for the injuries that he suffered. Next, I turn to Paul's lawsuit against Mary. I consider this to be the somewhat more subtle section. It's a lot less straightforward than the typical intentional tort analysis that we've done in the first lawsuit. I focus on duty, and I get into the problem that Mary has made this separate assurance, and that this separate assurance equals an assumption of duty. Next, importantly, you'll see that I find a home for the facts that Dina is a minor who lives at home. And since Mary knows that her daughter has got schizophrenia, she has a duty to foreseeable plaintiffs to act reasonably as she supervises her daughter. So you'll see, I am very precise about establishing two separate breaches of duty that may be relevant to the plaintiff's efforts to win damages from Mary. I focus on breach. Here, nothing I think you're going to find very surprising. And similarly, with regard to causation, it's not a very complicated or subtle analysis either. I reach damages, and the only important point I make here, other than just touching the base, is to indicate that punitive damages won't be available, given that the theory of liability is mere negligence. Ultimately, I focus very briefly on defenses, and I conclude that Paul will succeed, and he's going to win his negligence cause of action against Mary. Now, how about this vicarious liability issue? Here's an issue that I discuss only in two quick paragraphs. I start off indicating the basic rule, which is that usually parents aren't vicariously liable for the intentional torts of their kids. But I distinguish the special facts of this case from the ordinary facts that give rise to vicarious liability discussions, and I conclude that Mary has assumed a duty of her own. So even if she isn't vicariously liable for her daughter's conduct, as she might well be, she certainly is going to be found liable for her own negligence.